told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asks for anything back.
We have a matriarchal lineage to our Aboriginal mothers, and our Aboriginal mothers are the direct connection to the land for thousands of years.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Good evening. Thank you for being with us today. On behalf of Calgary Public Library, I welcome Royal Astronomical Society of Canada members and our patrons to this webinar lecture on Uncovering the Origin of Highest Energy Cosmic Rays with the VERITAS Gamma Ray Observatory. We have here with us our moderator Simon and tech support Brian from Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. And we also have here Hamza and myself, Lale, from Calgary Public Library. Simon will shortly be introducing our presenter, Dr. David Kida. Some housekeeping before we start. We will have Q&A session at the end at 8:40 p.m. Please ask your questions through Q&A tab on your Zoom controls. It's at the bottom of the screen. You can ask them throughout the lecture. No need to wait till the end to ask. If you have any technical related questions or questions to library, please ask them through chat. And now I will pass it to Simon, our moderator, to take over.
Thank you very much. And welcome everybody to tonight's lecture. So I'd like to welcome everybody to the March General Meeting of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada's Calgary Centre. We are one of 29 centres across the country created to enhance understanding of and inspire curiosity about the universe through public outreach, education, and support for astronomical research. You do not need to live in Calgary or even in Canada to join our centre. If you like this program and would like to support our nonprofit organization so we can continue to have more events just like this, please don't hesitate to join us. Information about joining can be found in the chat window. Your membership comes with the world-renowned Observer's Handbook, US edition for those at lower latitudes. Also with the membership comes a subscription to the premier night sky magazine Sky News and the Journal of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, which contains the latest research into various astronomical topics. You will become a member of a community of professionals and amateurs who share a common passion for the night sky. Join us for online social events, star parties, and once the pandemic abates, have full access to a local telescope rental program to see the night sky with all sorts of great equipment. The Royal Astronomical Society of Canada also offers observing programs where you can earn certificates and pins by finding a certain number of great celestial objects in the night sky. We will be continuing our PARSEC program next week for those Calgary Centre members who are interested in community science. PARSEC stands for Promoting Amateur Research and Scientific Exploration of the Cosmos. This program allows center members to research and collect data using their own equipment and contribute to journals and databases around the world. Next week, we are excited to have David Vita, a key player in the Global Meteor Network, speaking on revolutionizing meteor physics by building a global scale scientific instrument. Learn how to get involved in meteor science from your own backyard. If you have any questions, or are a Calgary RASC member who would like to join this program, please email David Brown at the address provided in the chat. Over the next month, we have a couple notable things to mention about the sky for the casual visual observer. Well, on March 20th, it will be the spring equinox, and the sun, the disk of the sun, will cross the equator. On March 30th, again, as with the beginning of March, the zodiacal light will be visible at northern latitudes for a couple weeks. And one of our local imagers, Bob Batania, took this picture of the zodiacal light. And you may be able to see this phenomenon from dark skies away from the city, the city's light pollution. Just because there isn't much exciting on the official list of events in the sky, it does not mean that the sky isn't full of great objects. March and April are typically the best months to view the Virgo cluster. If you've been intimidated reeling in these Messier objects, you are not alone. 3 years in a row, I told myself I would tackle this, but did I? No. If the weather is good, I will be outside finding these galaxies that make up nearly 15% of the Messier catalog. I hope you hold me accountable to that, and I'll report back in a month. We have some amazing astro imagers from Southern Alberta, and they have kindly provided some images for us to showcase this evening. Tom Evans took this wonderful picture of their Orion constellation at Abraham Lake, and it looks very cold there. I'm kind of excited that stuff's starting to warm up, but absolutely incredible picture of Orion with an awesome foreground. I love it. Paul de Rosenroll took this image of the California Nebula, and just absolutely incredible the detail that this shows and the dust clouds in front there, absolutely amazing. Kimberly Sibbald took this picture of the Flaming Star Nebula, and this is absolutely beautiful. This is like the Hubble Space Telescope right here. Dalton Wilson with the Rho Ophiuchi area and the cluster M4, Messier number 4, wonderful colors. This is incredible. Wow. These are some local imagers who do some great work right here in Southern Alberta. Eric Krauss with the Rosette Nebula. Wow. It's amazing how far technology has come to allow imagers to get such remarkable pictures. It's absolutely fantastic. And George Cavanaugh with the Wizard Nebula. Absolutely great image here, George. Did such a great job. And yeah, it certainly does look like a wizard. So I kind of see where it gets its name from. We have some news from the Calgary Centre this month. We will be commencing renovation of the Wilson Cooley Observatory this spring to modernize the facility for 21st century astronomy. We will have high-speed internet installed and a completely new exterior and interior. Over the next 5 years, we hope to equip the observatory with modern gear that will allow members to better be able to conduct science or just view the heavens above. If anyone is interested in helping with this effort, please do not hesitate to reach out to us. And the Wilson Cooley Observatory is it's a members facility where Calgary RASC members can come and set up their equipment or use the equipment that's already there to view the night sky from a darker area. And this is just out near De Winton. So it's away from the city lights, from the bulk of the city lights. And it's a beautiful ground to do astronomy with your friends or family. Now for the schedule of events that are coming up, as I mentioned before, March 25th, we have our Parsec meeting, and we'll be talking about meteor science and learn how you can get involved in doing that from your own backyard. On April 5th, we have CBC Radio 1 Astronomy with Don Haladiak, one of our longtime members, and that will be at 7:36 in the morning. April 9th, we have our new Observers to Visual Astronomy, our NOVA meeting. And these will be online as the pandemic still continues, but you'll learn great information and be involved in getting more into astronomy and participating in the hobby even more so. April 10th, the next night, we'll have the observers group meeting. This is a little bit more advanced, but it's still, it's a wonderful group of people who love to look at the night sky and learn some tips and tricks from them. Next month, we'll be welcoming two scholars from the University of Calgary who will be talking about scientific achievements between the times of antiquity, like the Ptolemy era of astronomy and the Renaissance. The Islamic Golden Age traditionally dated from the mid 7th century to the 13th century. And this talk will emphasize the advancement of astronomy and mathematics during this time period and how it has impacted the world we live in today. The first observatory and astrolabe were constructed during this time, which brought with it a plethora of advancements in astronomy and navigation. Join us next month for this free online lecture through the RASC and the Calgary Public Library and uncover the history of astronomy as you've never seen it before. A link to this program will be provided in the chat window. And now, before I introduce our speaker for this evening, I would like to just stop for a quick poll. And I invite you to participate in that poll so we can learn more about where you're from and to be better able to target our presentations for you in the future. Great, thank you everybody for participating in our poll. And now tonight, we are incredibly grateful to have a gamma ray researcher with us this evening. David Keita is a distinguished professor at the University of Utah in the Department of Physics and Astronomy. He also serves as the dean of the university's graduate school. David Keita is the head of the University of Utah's Experimental Gamma Ray Astronomy Research Group. He has led the development of new technologies for observational high-energy astrophysics, including work on the fly's eye, high-resolution fly's eye, the Very Energetic Radiation Imaging Telescope Array System, or VERITAS, Hawk, and the Cherenkov Telescope Array Observatories. David also works on the development of techniques for visual band imaging of nearby hot stars with an angular resolution better than 100 micro arc seconds. Professor Keita is the co-director of the University of Utah's Consortium for Dark Sky Studies, which is dedicated to the interdisciplinary study of the scientific and cultural importance of the dark night sky. He received the Utah Governor's Medal of Science and Technology and is a fellow of the American Physical Society. David earned his undergraduate degree at MIT and his PhD in physics from the University of Pennsylvania. Please join me tonight in welcoming Dr. David Keita to give this great presentation. Thank you.
Okay, hello everyone. I'm glad to be here tonight and to join you. And I want to thank the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada for inviting me to give this talk in front of a wonderful audience of people that are interested in astronomy. I also want to thank the members of the Calgary Public Library, the leadership, for all the work they do to put this series on. It's a fantastic series, and it's wonderful to see the range of topics in astronomy and astrophysics that are covered by the series. I'll get my talk up here, see if I can get it started. And okay, so as I mentioned, we're looking at the origin of the highest energy cosmic rays using the VERITAS Gamma Ray Observatory. And you can see from that picture, that's actually the VERITAS Observatory is south of Tucson on the Mexican border in southern Arizona. And it consists of four telescopes, actually. To be able to see a gamma ray, we have to have four telescopes all working together. And I'll talk about that technique a little bit later in the talk, but it's a really interesting type of telescope because it's not the type of thing that you've ever seen before. It uses a bunch of, so it's a tessellated mirror and it has a number of different segments and has a very high speed camera. So without further ado, let's begin. Now we're all familiar with the night sky as we look up, and this is what it looks like in the visible light. As was mentioned, we have all these great constellations that have been known for centuries and bright stars with different magnitudes. And so this is what we normally see when you look up at the sky. And this is the visible light is made of particles called photons. And photons have an energy of typically 2 to 4 electron volts. Now, not too many people have thought much about what an electron volt is, but I thought I'd walk you through a little bit of an understanding about what that means. So if I have a 1.5 volt battery, that's about 5 centimeters across, if I took one electron, and people know what an electron is, that's this fundamental carrier of charge that we use for electronics. If I make it go from one side to the other, it gains some energy and it gains 1.5 electron volts. So that's a very simple definition, 1.5 volt battery, put one electron across it, you get 1.5 electron volts. So that amount of energy could also be converted 100% into light. And it turns out that would be infrared light. So on the bottom here, I've got a scale of the visible colors, and it's a little bit shy of the red. It's sort of in the near infrared, the 1.5 electron volts. If I put two batteries together, then you wind up at 3 electron volts. And when you convert that to a wavelength of the light, it's in the blue now. And that's about 10 centimeters worth of D cells when you hook them together. And if I put 3 batteries, you get 4.5 electron volts, and that's ultraviolet light. So one of the things I like to point out is when you buy a LED flashlight, one of these white LED flashlights, you're always putting 3 batteries in it, or else the battery itself has to be about 3.5 or 4 volts. The reason is if you want white light, you need to have blue light be part of that. You need the full spectrum. And so you can't make blue light unless you have at least about 3.5 volts of energy. So that's why you need 3 batteries for those lights. You can't make a white light battery with just a single battery. So we're going to be talking about very high energy light. So that has the abbreviation VHE, and talk about energy of VHE energy and particles, cosmic rays, particles and light. So once you get above 1 million electron volts, then that would be 1 million batteries strung end to end. We call that high energy, it's called HE. And 10 to the 6 million batteries would be about 33 kilometers long. And I put up a picture of Calgary there. And it turns out that if you take the square area of Calgary and take a square root, it's about 30 kilometers. So that's a typical distance of the city of Calgary. So that would be a fairly large stack of batteries that you would need to get to 1 million electron volts. We're looking much more energetic. We're looking at about 1 million times 1 million. That's called a TeV, a tera electron volt gamma ray, or 10 to the 12th. So we need 10 to the 12 of these batteries to make up these very high energy particles. That one then, we kept on stacking those batteries up. We need 10 to the 12 of these batteries, which winds up being about 33 million kilometers. And people don't usually have a good sense of how far 33 million kilometers is, but there's something in the news going on right now. We just landed on Mars, and that's almost all the way to Mars from the Earth at the nearest approach. So that would be one gigantic stack of batteries that you would need to get to this 1 million MeV. There is a place on Earth where we make particles of this energy, and that's the CERN accelerator. People have seen this in the news. It's a very high energy beam, and it generates protons, two beams of protons that interact with each other. And you can see that there's this nice tunnel here, and the beams are kept in this magnetic field and confined in it, and they go around this 27 kilometer loop. So this is a little bit more technologically advanced than just using some batteries. The loop has about 27 kilometer circumference, and each of the proton beams is 7 TeV, so 7 times 10 to the 12th electron volts. And that costs about $9 billion to build this thing, and it's been doing some great work looking at the Higgs boson and trying to understand phenomenology beyond our common understanding about how particles interact with each other, looking for new extensions to the standard particle physics model. The highest energy particle I've detected was seen at the Fly's Eye Observatory in 1991. And this is one of the papers I wrote when I was a very young professor. So this one was called an extremely high energy. or EHE. And a good way to think about this is the energy of a bowling ball dropped on your toe. So if you take a bowling ball and you hold it right about your waist level and drop it on your toe and you feel that, that would be the energy carried by one particle, one cosmic ray, as it goes through the atmosphere, which is a lot of energy. It's a macroscopic amount of energy. 3×10^20 electron volts, or 30 billion TeV, I'm sorry. That winds up being 4.3 million LHC colliders, or you need 2×10^20 batteries. On the right-hand side, I show you the picture of the flies I experimented. It consisted of a bunch of small mirrors that had fast sensors in the front, and they would point to different directions on the sky. And so the entire sky was covered with these fast light sensors. They'd be read out at a few hundred thousand times a second, and we'd look for flashes of light, which would give us the direction and energy of those cosmic rays. Now, if I want to figure out how to make this on using the batteries, I thought I'd give you some idea how big that battery would be. First of all, the battery length winds up being 25,000 light years. So that's the distance to the nearest dwarf galaxy, Canis Major, which is quite a big battery stack. If you add up how much those batteries weigh, it'd be about 3×10^19 kilograms. So that's the weight of Saturn's moon Minima. So pretty large. It's not as big as our moon, but it's still a substantial chunk of matter that you'd have to build these batteries out of. And then the battery cost, I looked on the Amazon, and it was, for a single D cell, it was about $1.80 in the US. So you multiply that together, and it turns out it's about the 2018 global economy for 4 billion years is what you need to make that number of batteries. And just remember, the Earth itself is only 4.5 billion years. So it would have taken sort of the lifetime of the Earth so far just to manufacture these if we started a long time ago. So the big question is, how does this occur naturally? This is a really crazy energy, and it's something that we would have a hard time doing even with our best technology. How does this occur naturally? So to answer that question, we're gonna look at a different wavelength. So we're gonna put on a different set of goggles, which are called gamma ray goggles. And these are gamma rays that are observed, these VHE gamma rays, 1×10^12 times the energy of a regular photon that you would see with your visible eyes. And it turns out when you put these goggles on, the universe looks completely different. All the regular stars disappear. Most stars don't make this type of energy, but there are objects out there that are shining beacons in this type of light. And those are the things we're going to focus in on because they have the most potential for generating these high energy cosmic rays. So the night sky here, this is a picture of the full sky, all sky survey by the Fermi satellite in orbit around the Earth. This is around 2015. And the energy of these gamma rays is 10 GeV. So that's 10,000 MeV, or it's about 1% of a very high energy gamma ray. So the first thing that you see here is this prominent feature, this big red line going across. That's the galactic plane. And in the middle of it, there is the galactic center. And the reason why we see a lot of gamma rays coming from the galactic plane is there are cosmic rays that are generated by something. That's what we're going to try to discover where they come from. But they're propagating out of the center of the galaxy, and they're interacting with gas in the galactic plane. When they interact, they make particles called pions and kaons. We'll talk about those in a minute. But when those particles are created, they're unstable, and they decay and give you gamma rays. So what you're seeing is gamma rays being created by particle collisions in the gas of the galactic plane. There are also these things at high galactic latitudes. These are called blazars or AGN. So these are objects that are outside of our galaxy, and we'll see some examples of those. Those are galaxies, remote galaxies, well outside our galaxy, and they're fed by a gigantic supermassive black hole, 100 million solar masses, and it's generating a huge amount of power. And so those things show up like searchlights in the night sky. This is a really easy way to find these things by using these high energy gamma rays. Inside of our galaxy, there's also some sources. There are things called neutron star pulsars, which are remnants of supernova. We'll get some examples of those, and also supernova remnants. There's a little blob over here, these bright round things just off the galactic plane. That's the Crab Nebula over there. So there are many different sources here, and we're gonna be using our gamma ray eyes to try to understand where these highest energy cosmic rays might be coming from. I also wanted to mention there are these two things that were discovered about 5 years ago called Fermi bubbles. And these are around the galactic plane, some big bulges. You can actually see this lighter blue line. It's a diffuse emission. Something's going on in the galaxies to push cosmic rays and push gas outward from the center of the galaxy and vertical up and down. And that sort of pressure makes these things called Fermi bubbles. It's not understood what these things are, but they're huge and they have a gigantic amount of energy associated with them. Okay, so I started to talk out with it about a neutron star pulsar. And if you've been following astronomy lectures, you might know what a neutron star is. It's a piece of very, very dense matter. It's at nuclear density, but it has the mass of a couple suns. So it's got a very, very dense mass, but it's only got a radius of 10 kilometers. So again, a fraction of the size of Calgary, but the mass of the entire sun within that mass. These are created at the endpoint of stellar evolution of certain stars. And when the star goes into the supernova phase, the core can collapse and it gets to this ultra dense region. And when it collapses, it actually takes the magnetic field with it. So it takes the magnetic field that was part of the sun. And as it collapses down, the magnetic flux is conserved. So it actually gets concentrated. And we get a magnetic flux of about 10 to the 13 Gauss. If we remember that on Earth, the nominal magnetic field is a few Gauss in for the Earth's magnetic field. So this is a huge magnetic field. Also, the angular momentum of the star is conserved. So if it was rotating around perhaps in a 1 month or several week rotation period, when this thing collapses, it's like the ice skater bringing their arms in, the thing speeds up. And when you bring it down to 10 kilometers, it goes up to about 33 milliseconds here. So it has a very fast pulsar period. It has a huge amount of power, about 100,000 times the power of the sun. And theoretically, it has an energy. If you take a 10 to the 12th Gauss magnetic field and you spin it around, it's like a electric generator. You can calculate with a 33 millisecond period how much electric voltage you would generate. It turns out you can get something like 300,000 times TeV energy. So that's about 3% of that energy we would need to explain that super energy cosmic ray, the extremely high energy one that we had talked about. One of the things about a pulsar is where the magnetic field lines meet the neutron star, particles are created and they move along those lines and they crash into the neutron star. Negative particles go to one direction, positive particles go to the other. And the electric fields that are generated can be strong enough to actually lift material off the neutron star surface and then accelerate it around to the other side. The places where the particles are crashing into that neutron star makes a hot spot and it generates thermal radiation, invisible light. And those hot spots will, as it's rotating, occasionally point to the Earth and you'll see a flash of light coming to the Earth. And this is how the Crab Nebula was first seen. You can actually see it with a fast camera. It's quite bright. And if you took a video of it, you can actually see the 33 millisecond period if you stare at it and look at a fast film with this thing. So that's just one example of an extreme endpoint or a remnant of the stellar life cycle. This is a full diagram of where stars are born, how they evolve, and how they die. And going from the left-hand side, we have clouds of gas that are created perhaps from previous stars or supernova. And under certain conditions, the gas will start to collapse if it's cool enough and it has enough mass. And eventually you form massive stars, low mass stars, or brown dwarfs. That's kind of moving towards the right-hand side. Once they run out of their fuel, their hydrogen burning, then they start to collapse further. They're kept in a equilibrium for 10 to 100 or for hundreds of millions of years to billions of years. And the reason that they're in equilibrium is you have nuclear fusion going on at the center of the star. It's generating energy and the energy radiates outward and pushes back against the gas of the star. Whereas the gravity keeps on trying to bring that gas and collapse it down. So it's a cosmological fight between the fusion trying to push outward and the gas trying to hold everything in. And it stays remarkably stable over these 10 billion years until the central core runs out. When the central core runs out of energy, then there are no more photons left, no more energy to support against gravity. And so gravity does what it does, it starts to collapse. When it starts to collapse, it generates heat from the gravitational infall. The core starts to warm up. And even though there's no hydrogen fuel left to burn, there is residual helium left from that hydrogen burning. And at a certain temperature, the helium starts to burn and heavier elements are formed. And then as it collapses further, eventually you get carbon and silicon, other types of things burn. Now, one of the things you find going from the left-hand side to the right-hand side of the diagram is things on the left-hand side, the emission time is very, very long, 1 to 10 billion years. On the right-hand side, things evolve really quickly, on the order of months to minutes. The reason that is, when you start burning these heavier elements, you start making these particles called neutrinos as well. So you don't make very many neutrinos in the hydrogen burning, but when you start making helium or carbon or heavier element synthesis, you make these particles called neutrinos. And neutrinos are particles that they travel the speed of light and they can go straight to the center of the sun without ever interacting. So whereas the light has to take millions of years to escape from the core to come to the outside because it's interacting with the gas, to the neutrinos, the star looks like an open window and they freely stream out. So when you're doing the original hydrogen burning, there are very few neutrinos being created. And so the only way for the energy to escape is through the surface of the star. When you have a more advanced star beyond the main sequence, the energy starts to leak out through these neutrinos. And it's just a free escape. They just leave immediately so they don't have to hang around for a million years. So it's like having a leaky can. Once the neutrinos start, you start punching holes in that can and the water starts to fall out faster and faster. And the more it falls out, the more holes you punch in it, the higher the temperature goes, the more holes you punch and you get more and more neutrinos coming out. And so that's why the stellar evolution at the end only takes a few months to a few weeks to advance in the last stages of silicon and oxygen burning to go to the ultimate stage, which is the iron burning. Once you're in the iron burning stage, there's nothing left to hold up the star, so it will collapse and then it will go through a sequence where it makes a supernova. And then you have these supernova remnants that are left. So you may wind up with, depending on the mass of the original star, a black hole or this neutron star. And so that's going to the right-hand side. These remnants then make the pulsars or the black hole, or you can have gas that eventually winds up falling into the black hole and starts to accrete and makes X-ray emission and very high energy gamma ray emission. So it's that upper level here that we're spending most of our time thinking about where these high energy gamma rays come from. And that's what our telescopes see the best, are these pulsars, X-ray emission from black holes, really extreme remnants after the death of a star. A couple notable things about the process here. On the left-hand side, the energy that's released in a star goes to the main sequence. It's about 1% of the mass of the star. On the right-hand side, when this thing collapses, it can release 10 to 40% of the mass of the star into pure energy. So it's a much more efficient accelerator and much more efficient conversion from mass to energy. The emissions that we see on the left-hand side tend to be cooler emissions, radio, visible light, and up to X-ray. And then we start to see these really extreme things on the right-hand side, these very high energy to extremely high energy particles, just due to the fast time scale and the huge amount of energy being created. So this is going to be our cast of characters that we're going to look at tonight. We're going to look at possible sites of extreme energy accelerators. So look at these pulsars and pulsar wind nebulas. We're going to look at neutron stars that go around other stars. These are called high mass X-ray binaries. We'll look at binary neutron star mergers. You've probably heard about these from the LIGO and Virgo events. And so these things are fascinating. They generate a huge amount of energy as well. We're going to look at supernova shocks and something called TEV halos. And then the last thing we'll look at is these things called extragalactic blazars and gamma ray bursts. That's this object, Markarian 421-501, that I mentioned is one of those types of objects. Before we look at that, we'll talk about this crab pulsar. Before we do that, though, we're going to talk about the VERITAS Observatory. And VERITAS has a long relationship with the crab pulsar. It turns out that the crab pulsar was the first object to be seen at very high energies. The field of very high energy gamma ray astronomy started in the 1950s, but the first source wasn't seen until 1989, and that was the Crab Nebula. And that was seen by Trevor Weeks, who was the PI of the VERITAS Observatory and also the Whipple Observatory. which saw this in 1989. So this is a follow-up observatory. I worked on Whipple, and then I followed up by working on the Veritas Observatory. And Veritas replaced the sensitivity within a few years of the Whipple Observatory after the Veritas was completed. So this is a square array of four 12-meter diameter optical reflectors. As I mentioned, it's in Amado, Arizona, south of Tucson. The optics consist of these 1-meter hexagonal blanks. There's about 350 segments, and they're focused in a unique design called a Davis-Cotton design. I won't go into what that design is, but suffice it to say the mirrors are spherical, and they're put on a spherical optical support structure, but the two radiuses of curvature are different from each other. And what that does is it gives you a very wide field of view and gives you a very good spot size, really a good resolution over a fairly large field of view, which you can't do with a parabolic reflector. This detects very high energy gamma rays. As mentioned, these are about from that we call these things very high energy. So it's about 10% of those to about 100 times that very high energy mark that we had discussed before. It's the world's most sensitive very high energy gamma ray observatory. We detect the Crab Nebula. When we first looked at it in 1989, it took about 100 hours to observe it. Now we can observe it in about, we can observe the crab in about 5 minutes. Something that's a hundredth of a crab takes less than 25 hours to observe. So very dim sources now we can look at. It's been fully operational since May 2007, and it's gone underground some upgrades in terms of better sensors, improved electronics, improved triggering system, things like that in 2012. So it's actually operating tonight as we speak. So we're going to use the gamma radiation that we see from here to try to find the origin of these extremely high energy particles. To understand how these telescopes work, we have to understand the atmospheric Cherenkov technique. So on the left-hand side, you've got the atmosphere 20 kilometers up, and then here at ground level at Veritas at 1.4 kilometers, and we have a gamma ray which hits the atmosphere, and it makes pairs of particles as it goes to the atmosphere, makes a shower of particles actually. And these are made of gamma rays and electrons and positrons. The other things that hit the atmosphere are protons and iron nuclei. These look a little bit different. They'll penetrate a little bit further. And they also have a bunch of additional particles creating. So you look at the left-hand side, you're only seeing electrons and positrons here. But with these protons or iron, you see these charged particles, kaons, pions being made. These can decay and give you these heavy electrons called muons. And muons are very interesting because when they hit nearby the detector, they make these rings here in the image. So the thing you want to remember is gamma rays give you a nice clean image. It looks like a narrow cigar shape. And protons give you kind of ratty looking things with light all over the place. And it doesn't look so nice. And you could actually see these nice little rings here too. So if we want to try to identify the gamma rays and throw out these things, we look for nice clean signals and throw away things that don't look so nice. So we only see gamma rays and electrons, positrons when the primary gamma ray comes in. We have protons, we get the electrons, gamma rays, we see the muons. And I also had mentioned these neutrinos before. We also, these particle decays make these new electron. These are different types of neutrinos. And these don't interact with the atmosphere. They just go straight through the Earth and we never see them again because they don't interact at all with the atmosphere. But nevertheless, they are there and they're part of those showers. Okay, so the observing technique, like I mentioned, we have a very high energy particle which enters the top of the atmosphere, makes a cascade. This is about 8.5 kilometers long. And as the particles go through the atmosphere, they generate this light called Cherenkov light. It's a blue radiation. And it has an opening angle of about 1.5 degrees. It's kind of like a sonic boom, except we're in light. And so on the ground, we see a pool of light about 120 meters around. And we put our telescope here, and if it sees that flash of light, then it'll see the gamma ray. So here's our 12-meter diameter mirror. We look at the sky. It's got a camera here, 499 pixels. Each of these pixels can read out a photon to 1/1,000,000th of a second. So it has to be very, very fast to see this light. And then the cameras are read out by a rack of electronics down in, there's a trailer here. So there's a bunch of cables that go down the arms and they come into this trailer. And so we have 500 channels of this readout electronics. And then the readout electronics then gives us the picture of the gamma ray that we then analyze and we use for selection of the gamma rays. If you want to get a better idea of what it would look like if your eyes were fast enough to see these Cherenkov light, this is what you would see. So we have a shrank off light makes this, or the gamma makes a shrank off light cone on the ground of blue light. And if we're looking with this camera here, what you see is this image, and we have these small pixels that were part of the VERITAS camera, and you see this sort of cigar-shaped image here. And that cigar-shaped image, it points, if I go from the bottom of the earth to the top, that's the timing of this thing. So this thing points to someplace in the sky. And so we know that where this gamma ray came from, it had to have come from in this plane here. So the plane itself is really well-defined in the perpendicular direction, but along the plane direction, it's fairly uncertain. So we can't do grid astronomy there. So what we do is we use three or four telescopes, and each one will give us a different perspective on the gamma ray shower. So we see a shower in this direction and a shower in this direction from the other camera. The intersection of the three planes gives us a point in the sky, and that's what gives us this extremely high angular resolution that we get in the VERITAS observatory. In fact, it is the highest angular resolution of anything above the X-rays. So we've seen exquisite pictures of the X-ray sky using Chandra and next generation X-ray telescopes. We can't get to that resolution, but we have the best resolution above that energy. Even the observatories in outer space can't match this resolution. We're about a factor of 10 to 100 better than those observatories that are in outer space. So we mentioned the Crab Nebula, and this is a picture of it that was taken both by Chandra and also the Hubble Space Telescope. You can see it has this filamentary structure on the outside. The Crab Nebula, as you remember, is about 1,000 years old, and it was actually historically seen. There's also this blue light here, which is from Chandra. This is X-ray emission caused by interactions of particles with the gas. These filamentary structure is actually fluorescence of various molecules in the ejecta, individual calcium lines and silicon lines and other elements that were formed. They're being excited and they fluoresce in individual frequencies. So that's why you see this beautiful filamentary structure. At the center of the object, this is in X-rays. You can see the neutron star pulsar here. This is a little dot right in the center. And you can also see these rings moving outward. What's happening here is this pulsar, if you watch it, you can see this thing just blinks just a little bit. And as this thing is pulsing, it actually pushes particles outward in one direction, in this direction. And as it's rotating, that particle stream is kind of like a hose, and it keeps on pushing this ring outward. And then it hits this outer nebula and makes these bright rings, and it hits the gas. So we looked at, this is one of our first observations in 2007. We looked at the Crab Nebula with VERITAS. And so the way that we do the observations, we point at the source itself and we just do a count, right? We say, we see these points on the sky. We throw out the ratty looking things and keep the ones that look like nice cigar images and reconstruct where they are in the sky. And so if we pointed at the sky for about an hour or so, we would see this type of image with a concentration of sources here, of events here, which are gamma rays. But there is also a background associated with it. And so those are caused by cosmic rays that hit the field of view. And we want to reject those. There would be cosmic rays that are hitting in this center as well. And we want to estimate what those are and subtract that out to get the true flux of the gamma ray. So we do point on source. We point to a place in the sky where there are no sources, and we measure how many cosmic rays are generated across the field of view. Then we subtract those two. And so then over an hour, this is the excess that we see. And then we can convert the excess into a standard deviation significance. So this is about 30 sigma. It took us in about an hour to be able to see this. This was early days, and we've improved the sensitivity substantially since then. But nevertheless, you can see this nice point source of gamma rays coming from the Crab Nebula. Next. Okay, I mentioned that there's a pulsar associated with the Crab Nebula. And so it's seen in the optical, but it's also seen by the Fermi satellite right around about 10% of that VHE energy. So that's this plot here on the right-hand side. This is the phase of the orbital period. So the standard thing that people do in astronomy is you repeat this twice so you can see the structure right around zero. So here is where it's pointing at us, then it points away. And then this is the interphase, and then you have a second lobe here, which is probably another hot spot, but it's not pointing directly at us. And then you have another interphase, and then you go back to the main phase over here. We looked at this with VERITAS, and in fact, we see this same sort of pulsed emission coming from those hotspots, or perhaps particles being generated near those hotspots. This was originally thought to be impossible up until we discovered it. People had thought that this thing would cut off, the gamma ray radiation would cut off in a exponential cutoff, so they expected to go along this line over here. But when we measured it over here, and there's a clear excess in the VHE region of these pulsed emissions here. Subsequent to this, the MAGIC collaboration has also done even deeper observations, and they've shown that it goes even higher up to this VHE energy in the pulsed emission. So we know that particles are getting created up to the VHE emission here in this object, and probably much higher than that as well. Okay, so I mentioned that we have a pulsar. We have the pulsar at the center, and this is going to show you a little bit what I was mentioning about those rings moving outward. As the pulsar spins and rotates in space, it shoots out a beam of particles, and it becomes a bunch of concentric rings that move increasingly outward towards the supernova remnant on the outside, this gas region. And when those energetic particles hit it, they start to excite the gas. They make these pions and neutrinos and other things. And so that gives us the steady emission that we see from the crab. So we see two components, the pulsed emission, which comes from the neutron star itself. And then there's a steady emission, which comes from the nebula outside of it as the particles interact with it. So a good way to see how high in energy that those particles can go is to look with a different observatory. I also work on this Hawk Observatory in Mexico. This is at about 14,000 feet. And I won't go through how it detects gamma rays, but it can do it at very high energies. And so we just published a paper a few years ago about the Crab Nebula, and we were able to detect with this energy all the way up to 56 TeV, so 56 times that high energy. And that implies if you do a model, you're getting particles up to 100 TeV or 100 times that very high energy. That's the battery stack that's going from us to Mars is generating things up to 100 times that size. So the next thing I want to talk about is high mass X-ray binaries. High mass X-ray binaries consist of a neutron star that may be orbiting around a hot star like a BE star. If you remember what a BE star is, it has a temperature of about 20,000 degrees, about 10 to 15 solar masses. And the energetic radiation around this thing is so substantial that instead of having an accretion disk, many of them have a decretion disk. So as it's spinning around, the combination of the centrifugal motion of the star that makes the gravity low on the equator of the star, plus the high pressure, can actually move particles off the star and make it decrete rather than accrete. So high mass X-ray binaries often have this BE star with an accretion disk around it. We're going to talk about LS1-61303. This is another one that I've been studying for several years. So it has a compact object, and the object itself is not known what it is. It's somewhere around 2 to 3 solar masses, so it could be a neutron star, it could be a black hole, and it's in a very eccentric orbit around this BE star. It has about let's see if I can show the movie here. This is a nice movie. It has about a 26.5 day orbital period. And one of the things that they see is they see this orbital period modulation of both the optical radio across the entire electromagnetic spectrum. You can see that there's a sort of orbital modulation of this across the whole spectrum. So we decided to go look for this in gamma rays. And so these are observations that we did in 2009, 2007, 2008, 2009. So you can see the BE star at the center here, and the yellow dot moving around is representation of the compact object as it moves. And so one of the problems is that we don't observe in the full moonlight, so there are places where we can't observe it. So you can see when we're at this place of the orbit, we don't see anything. And then we get to the apastron, which is the furthest place away, and we actually see a lot of gamma rays coming from it, and then it disappears again, and then we can't see it from the moon. So this is one of the frustrating things about LS1. Is that the 26.5 day period is pretty close to the moon's period. So it takes several years for it to precess. So that way you can see different parts of the orbital period. So you can't observe the emission over the entire orbit in a single year. It actually takes a campaign of about 8 or 10 years to fill out all the different phases and see what's going on. But nevertheless, this is kind of extraordinary seeing this emission at a pastron rather than at when it's at closest approach. Now, all of us think about, well, we've got a BE star, we're gonna be at closest approach, a lot of gravity, a lot of gas, so we should see a lot of interactions going on. So we should see gamma rays going there. This is our 10-year survey of the source. And if we look at these are sky plots by VERITAS, and you can see the brightest emission here occurs over here about 0.73 when it's way away from the BE star and this decretion disk, which is nearby. And you see a little bit of persistent emission as it's going around, but it's really bright when it's furthest away. So what could be going on here? What we think is going on is the decretion disk is so dense that in fact, when the gamma rays are being created nearby the star, it's actually interacting with that gas and it's attenuating the gamma rays. So maybe one of the ways to think about it is if I have a flashlight and I'm underwater, I can't see it, but when I poke my head above the water, above the surface of the gas, then I can see it and then it dunks back under again. So it's kind of periodically peeping its head above the atmosphere and showing us the emission, and then it ducks back again, and then it can't be under a cloak and it can't be seen anymore. There's also some other exceptional activity with the source. We see very large flaring, and it depends on which year you're at, but sometimes we'll see 30% of the crab flaring. Normally the quiescent emission is about 5% of the crab, but the quiescent emission generally occurs right around this apastron phase here. So we think it may have something to do with how it interacts with the gas and the region there. This was the brightest flare we saw in 12 years. And it also has a strong correlation with the X-ray, which tells us a little bit more about where the origin of the flares might be coming from. To make things even more interesting, we said we've got this 26 and a half day period, and it varies with orbital phase, but there's another period associated with it, and it's called the superorbital phase. This is seen in the radio and X-ray as well, and we are beginning to see it in the gamma rays. It's 1,667 days, and so the question is, where does this weird number come from? What we think it is that accretion disk actually is wobbling somewhat, and the orbit of the star as it moves around sometimes lines up with it in one way, and then as it precesses around, it changes the geometry, and it's less efficient at making gamma rays under certain geometries. And then it precesses back again, and it starts to become more efficient at making gamma rays. So the way to think about LS1 is it's kind of the emission is really complex. It's affected by the emission geometry, precession of the disk, modulation by local gas density. These are things that we see in many of these accelerators, but it's kind of like a Swiss watch. It's got all these little ticking gears that we can listen for, and we try to pick apart what's inside that watch by listening to the ticks on the outside. Fascinating and fun system to work at. Particle acceleration, we're seeing 10 times the very high energy gamma rays, 10 TeV. And as again, we see this modulation and flaring through interactions with the gas disk. So these two guys look like they could be a source of VHE cosmic rays, and maybe not getting up to this extremely high energy, but they've got steady and periodic flaring emission. I want to talk now about binary neutron stars. And neutron stars mergers came into astronomy with only the past few years with the advent of the LIGO gravitational wave detector. It can observe gravitational wave transits caused by black hole mergers, neutron stars with black holes, and neutron star mergers. This shows gamma rays being detected simultaneously with a gravitational wave event. So on the bottom here, this shows the chirping that's seen in the gravitational wave detector, and it speeds up at the end as the two things in spiral to a point where it's called zero here, the time for merger, and that's when they merge. And just shortly afterwards, the Fermi satellite in orbit sees the entire sky, saw these flares coming from the exact same place in the sky. So this is pretty much a dead ringer that the two neutron stars, as they're interacting, are accelerating something to some high energies. It turns out that the energies that are observed only went up to about 1 MeV. So this is about 0.1% of that very high energy radiation. VERITAS does follow-ups on these, but we've seen no emission to date from any of these objects, but it will continue to keep observing. So this one probably is, This one probably, I put a red on here because it only has short flares and the energy is quite low. And so these probably won't be our extreme energy accelerators that we're looking for, but they're fascinating nevertheless. We'll talk about some supernova shocks and TV halos. So I mentioned that Hawk Observatory, and Hawk is very good at looking for extended emission. It has a much wider field of view than VERITAS does. And we published a paper just a few weeks ago, 11th of March. So that's 1 week ago today. It came out in Nature Astronomy, so you can look it up. And what this consisted of, we were looking at a wider field of view around an OB2 cluster. So this is a bunch of O and B stars that are close together. They have strong winds. And we see some prominent sources, point sources of emission here. But the question is, what's this other junk around here on the outside? This is not supposed to be here. So we made a model of these point sources and subtracted them off. And we're left with this sort of cocoon of bright emission of gamma rays. Now we've seen this before. We saw the galactic plane, and we knew that cosmic rays, when they interact with the gas around the galactic plane, they make high energy gamma rays by making these things called pions, and the pions decay and give us gamma rays. So by looking at this, we say there's a residual bubble of high energy emission, 100 times this VHE emission. It has a huge volume. The diameter of this thing is 100 parsecs. So that's gigantic. And so it has to be a significant source of PEV cosmic rays. This is or 100 times the very high energy cosmic rays. I thought I'd show one picture from the paper, and it's the one on the right here that you want to look at. If we look at the emission going outward from the center of that bubble, this is in parsecs now. This dotted line over here is our local cosmic ray density that we see here at Earth generated by the, and so we see a kind of a low level here. This is the number of cosmic rays that are seen in that galaxy, and this is the 10 TeV, 10 times the very high energy stuff. And you see it's kind of flat. So what that means is those gamma rays, or those cosmic rays, are confined and they're not escaping. They're just milling around and staying within that bubble. If we go to high energies at 10 times more energy, 100 times the VHE, you actually see that they drop as it move outward, and you go close to the source, they go upward. This means that they're made at the center, and as they're leaving, they actually don't bend as much in the magnetic field and they escape. So this is a dead ringer for a source of cosmic rays, showing cosmic ray escape and also confinement. So really a super neat object. It's the first time anybody's ever seen this type of cosmic ray confinement in a single object. So these are great objects, 1,000 times this very high energy emission. So this is a much more likely source of cosmic rays than these objects over here. Last one I'll talk about is the extragalactic blazars and gamma ray bursts. So as I was looking for a picture of a quasar, the first thing I came up with was a picture of Marvel magazine. So apparently quasar is the cosmic avenger. And so we're gonna speak a little bit tonight about the untold origins of quasar. So quasars are found at the centers of galaxies outside of our galaxy. They tend to be elliptical galaxies, but they also are seen in other types of galaxies as well. And if you look at the core of the galaxy, there is a supermassive black hole. And the black hole itself is somewhere between 0.1 and 100 million masses of the sun. There is a big question as to how you make such a large black hole at the center, and it's not understood how they form. Most galaxies aren't around long enough for these things to sort of spiral inward to each other and coalesce. So there's still a lot of uncertainty as to where they come from. The energy source here is gravitation, things falling inward. As we mentioned before, you can liberate up to 40% of the mass of whatever falls in and turn directly into radiation according to E equals mc squared. So the power implied by this thing is 10 to the 40th watts is a typical energy that you see from these things. That's 10 to the 14 of our sun, or about 100 times the power of our galaxy. So again, huge amount of power coming out of this single object. They're observed to give both steady and episodic flaring emission on all different wavelengths, radio, visible infrared, X-ray, and gamma ray. The interesting thing is we are actually in the old age of the AGNs. AGNs were born quite a long time ago. So the peak in the redshift is 1 to 3. So if you go to, that's about where the universe is about half the size of where it is now. So these things were made in the early universe, and a lot of them have stopped operating now. They kind of go extinct after a while. Maybe the accretion stops, or one of the things that is thought that the radiation is so intense that it pushes the gas away, and then it has nothing left to feed on after a while. So sort of similar to that star. We talked about that there, the radiation pressure at the center of the star pushes away the gas and keeps it in equilibrium. One of the interesting facts is the active galactic nuclei, or these quasars, they generate about 20% of the universe's radiated energy. So if you look at all the photons in the universe, 10 to 20% are generated by these objects. Huge sources of energy. There's two ways to view this, and it depends on how lucky you are. If you're looking on the side, you get something called a radio galaxy. So you see, you don't see the central core here, but you see these long radio lobes, and you can pick these up in the radio. These are generally way outside the galaxy. Over here, they extend for millions of light years outside the galaxy. If you happen to have the right orientation, you can look down this jet tube. That's called a blazar. And it turns out that along that jet tube, we see very high energy gamma ray emission. Those are interesting objects for that. So here's a nice movie that I picked up from NASA. And it just shows you what it looks like seeing a radio galaxy from the side. There's this dusty torus, and you really don't see a whole lot except for these prominent jets on the side. And you can actually see superluminal motion of things moving along the jets when you're looking on the side. We, on the other hand, will be using the VERITAS telescope to look at it edge on. And you can see when something falls into the black hole, it makes a jet of energy and it propagates outward at a superluminal speed, apparent superluminal speed. And so that's where you can see flares from these objects. So we did an interesting observation of the source RGB-2243. We called it the Christmas flare. It occurred on Christmas Eve in 2014. We happened to be looking at the source because the Fermi telescope had indicated that this thing was giving out some unusual radiation at lower energies. It was in an elevated state. So we decided to turn the VERITAS telescopes on it. And over the course of a day or two, we had never seen it before. It suddenly gave us a flare of gamma rays at the highest energies, 10 to 20 times what it normally would do. It has a long-term low emission state as well. And so this is the time, this is the light curve for it. Here's the time. Fermi started seeing a little bit of emission here. So we started looking and immediately we saw this flare there. And as we observed it, the emission decayed off by Fermi, went back to this quiescent level, and we haven't seen it since then. So one of the things about these objects is it can flare and then disappear for 6 months, a year, could be many years, and then start to flare up again. So again, we still don't understand the mechanism fully. I wanted to point to a really exciting observation that happened in 2017, in September 22nd. And this was the ice cube neutrino detector in the South Pole. It observed some of these neutrinos that we mentioned before. They are high energy neutrinos that came from whatever source it was, came from that armpit of Orion, and it made both gamma rays and neutrinos that hit the ice, and was observed under, oops, see if I can get that to work. So if you look at these strings of these light sensors underground, it saw a flash of light caused by the neutrino interacting with the ice, making one of these particles called a muon, and then the muon left shrank off light. So not too much different than what we're doing with the gamma rays. Here we're doing, there we're doing the atmosphere and looking at the shrank off light. Here they're looking at a charged particle going through ice and measuring the shrank off light. This was, they have some pointing to this thing. It's 120 TeV neutrino at least. So 120 times is very high energy. And they can get a direction. It points back to this blazar TXS 0506 plus 56. So one of the things I wanted to point out about this thing, if we've got this central black hole here and it's gonna emit something, it could be emitting gamma rays. And we saw this before, we thought about VERITAS. The gamma ray comes in, hits some gas, makes electrons and positrons, and you only get those in gamma rays. However, if we had protons, carbons, nitrogen, iron, it hits the gas, it makes all these pions, kaons, muons, electrons. And these things can decay and give us these neutrinos. And that's what Ice Cube sees. So the smoking gun signature here is if we see both gamma rays from the source with VERITAS and we see these neutrinos, we know that it wasn't a gamma ray being made at the source. It was actually protons, carbons, nitrogen, iron. That's what's being made at the source here. There's those particles are being accelerated there. So for the first time, you can say we have smoking gun evidence of cosmic rays, charged cosmic rays coming from these objects. So we observe both gamma rays and neutrinos. We get the origin of high energy cosmic rays out of this. So VERITAS looked at this and other gamma ray observatories looked at this as well. This is the location of it. Like I said, it's kind of near Orion's armpit over here, and that's where the neutrino burst was seen. Veritas followed up on this and did some sources I mentioned before. This little square here is where TXS-0506 is known to exist. The galaxy is known to exist from the radio observations. The green dot is a neutrino source position from Ice Cube. And then they say that there's an error associated 50% confidence level and 90% confidence level. In the background, we have the significance that we observed this with the Veritas Observatory. So you can see our bright source here lines right up with TXS-0506 and the neutrino source position. So we can say here is there's TV gamma ray emission in coincidence with the neutrino emission. There's also persistent emission that was observed in the months following it by Veritas. So this is an amazing result. And it heralds in the first time that we've observed an extragalactic source in both gamma rays and also other wavelengths at the same time, both neutrinos as well as light. So these extragalactic, I give them a green color here. The energy is 1,000 times the very high energy. It could go much higher, we don't know. But we also see this TeV neutrino and the gamma ray emission at the same time. And so this tells us that there are definitely cosmic rays being emitted here. So in retrospect, we're doing astronomy now with some new messengers. Previously, we've been using photons. Everything we've known for the past 300 years, we've been doing with photons and visible light. And then over the past 15, 20 years, we've actually added other messengers. We've added neutrinos and gravitational waves. And by looking at these things in coincidence, we can look at different parts of the star and look at different astrophysical phenomena. Remember that gamma rays come from electromagnetic force. Neutrinos are a representation of the weak force. Gravity is a representation of the gravitational force. And then cosmic rays actually come, they're actually a representation of the strong force. And we're starting to see where they come from. So now we're actually doing astronomy with messengers from all four forces, whereas previously the messengers were only the electromagnetic thing. So that's kind of a game changer. The National Science Foundation in the United States has now a big program in multi-messenger astronomy to encourage people to do these multi-messenger approaches, not just multi-wavelength, but multi-messenger approaches to understanding our universe. So gamma rays, they look at optically thick regions near the black holes, much deeper than you can see with regular light. Look at neutron stars, supernova. You can pierce through the supernova shell and see to the center of those. You can see these blazars. Neutrinos probe even deeper. They can go into the side, in the center of a star. They can look at blazar cores and jets where even gamma rays would be attenuated. So we can look deep into processes we can never see before. Gravitational waves, we can measure black hole and neutron star masses, even though we can't see them. We can see their spins, mergers. We can see things being ripped apart tidally and put back together again in new types of objects and the birth of new elements out of the gravitational wave. So really, really just neat stuff. Our multi-messenger observations, we're uncovering new types of extreme accelerators, or at least evidence in the objects that we've been studying. Pulsars and high mass binaries, we're seeing about 100 times those very energies, about 1,000 times that very energy. That's the CERN accelerator and supernova remnants and halos. And the blazars and quasars, 1,000 times certainly, and it may go up to quite a bit higher than that, but we see a direct cosmic ray signature. The extremest highest energy accelerators, that was the one that we wanted to see 10 million times the very high energy. That's my particle I saw back in 1991. We still don't know where it came from. Blazars and quasars, these things are big beasts. They are a likely bet to do something, but there might be some other things as well. People are also looking at those Fermi bubbles that we're seeing. We don't understand what those are as well. They're gigantic and they have a lot of energy, and that might be another possible source. So with that, I will conclude, and I thank you for listening, and I'm glad to take questions about tonight's talk.
Oh, thank you very much, Dr. Kita. That's amazing, and spending time in that end of the electromagnetic spectrum, I don't think many of us have done that before, so thank you very much. We'll go move to our question and answer period. And if you have a question, please don't hesitate to put that in the Q&A section. You can find that at the bottom of your screen. And we will ask the questions that are put up. The first question is what are the gamma ray telescopes that are in space, and how many are there, and what are they kind of used for?
So the most famous one right now is the Fermi satellite, which I showed the all sky plot that they did. And that one was launched about 2008, and it's been operating for 10 years now. And it does an all sky survey about every 90 minutes as it orbits the Earth. So it's an all sky survey, and it looks at these very high energy gamma rays. It's something called the silicon tracker is what main. It's something that people use in particle accelerators. It's the same technology, but it's small. It's only on the order of a tabletop. It's not huge. And so we know that these particles have a very low flux. That high energy cosmic ray we talked about, it's one per square kilometer per century. So that could never detect anything like that. You'd have to wait tens of thousands of years for it to hit that detector. Even the gamma rays we look at, we see a few per minute over 10,000 meters. So whereas they might see one photon at a fraction of a very high energy gamma ray, we would see tens of thousands. So we would see a whole spectrum of them where they just see one object. So they have their use because they operate both day and nighttime. VERITAS only operates on nighttimes when the weather is good. And so they sort of complement each other. Our angular resolution is better than theirs. Their energy resolution is a little bit better than ours. And their particle rejection is a little bit better than ours. There are a couple other satellites. There's an Italian satellite up with a little bit lower energy range. There's a Japanese or a Chinese telescope that was launched recently as well. And there are some proposed next generation instruments that are up there. These instruments generally last for about 10 years. And so we're kind of on a third generation of telescopes now. The first gamma ray observations were made in the 1960s, and they were actually top secret. The first gamma ray telescopes were put up in 1963. And I don't know if people know what 1963 was, what the important was. That was the year that we signed the Atmospheric Test Ban Treaty. And the reason why we signed it was the fact that we could detect gamma rays from space, because we could put a satellite up and look for people that were violating the treaty. So the US was not gonna sign it until we could actually verify that nobody on Earth was making atomic bombs that would make low energy gamma rays. And when they first put that up, they started seeing gamma ray bursts. They didn't tell anybody for about 10 years that they were seeing it until NASA put a regular gamma ray satellite up. And when they saw the first gamma ray burst showing up, the US Air Force said, yeah, we've been seeing those. Now we don't know what they are. So that's been going on since the mid 60s, but the first NASA mission is about 1971. So a particular reason why a neutron star spins so rapidly. Like I said, it works the exact same way as the ice skater with their arms out. And so you can think about the star being that way. The star has got a very large extent, it's gigantic. And then when it collapses, it all goes down to a very small point. So it's rotating on the order of a month or so. And you put the radius of that in, and you have to conserve angular momentum. And so when you bring the thing down to a small center, 10 kilometers, it turns it's got to spin up. One of the interesting things is no neutron star can spin faster than a millisecond. So we see pulsars that spin up to as fast as a 1 millisecond period. And when you get beyond that, there are none. The reason there are none is it can't survive. If it spins faster than that, the neutron star actually has such centripetal acceleration on the outside that it actually breaks up and falls apart. So it sort of cracks and splits outward. And so that's why you don't see those. So there's a limit. And in 1988, there was an astronomer in New Zealand that claimed they saw a half a millisecond pulsar until they found out that it had to do with their sky camera. They were picking up pickup noise from their sky camera, and they turned it off and went away. So they had to retract that paper. So that was quite a shock. So that's where it comes from. It's just the same thing, like you pull your arms in, you start spinning faster.
Right. Okay. What about black hole mergers? Are they different from neutron star mergers?
Yeah, it's not clear whether black hole mergers would ever make gamma rays. That's an open question. The only one that's been seen so far is a neutron star merger, because it doesn't have the event horizon the same way. And so therefore things can escape. If you have two black holes, you have an event horizon. So you could maybe make gamma rays right where they make contact and interact. The question is, would they ever escape or not? But on the other hand, you know, don't count out nature. When you're dragging two very massive things together, you also make a lot of shocks nearby it. And those shocks can work with the gas that's a little bit further away, and they can potentially accelerate things. So maybe it's at a lower flux level, but we expect at some point we may actually see a black hole merger. The second thing there is all the black hole mergers that have been seen so far are much further away than that neutron star collision. That one was actually the closest gravitational wave event that's been seen so far. So it means that it was brighter in the electromagnetic spectrum than most of them are. Most of the black hole ones are much further away. So even if they were as bright as that neutron star collision, it'd be a lot harder to be able to see that.
Now, are extreme high energy looking at gamma radiation or high speed particles?
So VERITAS looks at the gamma radiation because the high energy particles, they get bent in the galactic magnetic field. And they also get bent in the magnetic field between our galaxy and other galaxies. So they're not going to be able to point back to each other. In fact, this is one of the reasons why, if you look at about 1,000 times the very high energy, those cosmic rays there, the curvature in the magnetic field of the galaxy, we know what the galactic magnetic field is. It turns out it's about the size of the arm of the galactic, just the thickness of that arm. And so they can be confined there. When you go a little bit high energy, they're no longer confined. The radius gets bigger. And so they're thought to escape above that energy. And one of the things that's seen in the charged particle spectrum is you actually see right around that 1,000 times the very high energy, it starts to drop off rapidly. So people think that that may be a confinement effect, or it could be due to an accelerators just don't work well above that energy. But we see cosmic rays well above that energy. And so we don't think that they come from our galaxy. We think they must come from an external galaxy. But unfortunately, they're not going to point back to it. They're going to bend, except for at the very highest energy. If you had a proton, it might be within a few degrees of the source. But looking outside the galaxy, there's a lot of galaxies within a few degrees. So it's hard to say where it's going to come from. So we look for the gamma rays at the same time. And if we see the gamma rays, they come straight from the source, and that may tell us where those things came from.
Oh, that's great. Somebody asks, can you have a quasar merger, and what would that look like?
There was an astrophysical journal, or was it astronomy, last month. There was a discussion of a galaxy which had two supermassive black holes, and it was off-center. And so it looks like maybe it was something from two galaxies that had collided, and they were doing some kind of a dance associated with it. And the mass was not at the center of the galaxy or the gas. It was offset from it. So yeah, it's going to be rare, but I wouldn't doubt that we see it at some point. In fact, the next generation of LIGO detectors, it turns out that if you look at gravitational wave detectors, the in-spiral time tells you what size of arms you need. So it turns out that the arms that we're using for in the LIGO experiment and the Virgo experiment, they're on the order of tens of kilometers, and they're sensitive to individual fast in-spirals. Those larger things, like having two supermassive black holes interacting, you need a much longer arm to look for those things. They're gonna be much slower as they slowly in-spiral to each other. So you need something on the order of perhaps the orbit of the Earth. And so that's the LISA project. You probably have heard about the LISA space interferometer. It's gonna have arms which are a fraction of the Earth's orbit. And when you do that, you can actually start looking for these supermassive black hole collisions, which you can't see on Earth.
Cool. Somebody mentioned that Antarctic neutrino was reported as an anti-neutrino. Is that correct?
The one from TXS was not. That was a regular neutrino. But there was a paper that just came out, I think a couple weeks ago, where they identified a neutrino, which looks like an anti-neutrino. So yeah, you can get those. Remember, we've got both those positive kaons and negative kaons. So a positive kaon will give you one type of neutrino, and the negative will give you the anti-neutrino. They're sort of anti-particles from each other. Pi plus and pi minus will give you opposite signs neutrinos. So you can get those type of neutrinos, anti-neutrinos and regular neutrinos, just out of those interactions.
Oh, that's fascinating. Somebody asks, how frequently do we see cosmic rays?
It depends on the energy of the cosmic ray. Mm-hmm. If you look at that VHE energy, you see them on the order, something like the Fermi satellite, they see tens to hundreds per minute hitting that satellite. If we go to that extremely high energy one that I talked about, that would be one per square kilometer per century or less. So then the question is, how do we observe it with fly's eye? how do we, what, did we wait around a century? It turns out, no, we just had something that was on the order of 100,000 square kilometers. And so you just had to wait for a couple of years to be able to see it. So that's how you wind up doing it.
Okay. Given that neutrinos pass right through the Earth, what are they interacting with at the ice cube to generate a measurable signal?
So it depends on the energy of the neutrino. It turns out that the low energy neutrinos can pass straight through the Earth, but the cross-section or the interaction probability as you go to higher energy neutrinos, it starts to increase. And in fact, when you get to, it would be 10 million times that very high energy, it turns out that your Earth is opaque to neutrinos. They actually will always interact at that point. So that's at 10 to the 17 electron volts, the Earth becomes opaque to them. These were seen at about 1,000 times less energy, but nevertheless, the cross-section is larger, and so some fraction of them are going to interact in the ice. But that's why they need a really big detector. If you need it to be, you know, the size of 10 Eiffel Towers tall and quarter mile across, something like that, to be able to see a few of these per day. Ice Cube is going into something called Gen 2, where they're going to increase the size by another factor of 2. And then there's a proposal to get another factor of 5 to 10 in the next decade coming out of the decadal survey. They're preparing for that.
Well, that's great.
Instead of seeing one from TXS, they'll see 10 or 15 or 20 from a burst, which would be great. It'd be really cool.
Mm-hmm. That's really cool. Now, are gamma ray bursts caused by one particular source or various sources?
So when they first saw the gamma ray burst, they were thinking it was just one source, but now we know that there are multiple places where they can occur from. There are very fast ones that the burst only lasts for a fraction of a second. And many of those have a very soft spectrum. And so sometimes they also repeat as well. They're called soft gamma repeaters. Those are thought to come from magnetars. So a magnetar is it's like the neutron star, except for it has even more magnetic field associated with it. So much that as a magnetic field is spiraling around, it actually, the magnetic lines can cross each other like a rubber band and it'll snap back and it'll make an extremely high energy flash of energy associated with particles moving along that. So it's called magnetic reconnection. So that's what those fast ones, they come from these things called magnetars, and there's a number of them that are known now. This is in about the past 10 years they've identified magnetars. The longer ones are thought to occur at cosmological distances. They've seen by doing fast follow-up in X-ray and then optical where the gamma rays came from. This is a kind of an elaborate dance that you do to find these things. You've got a gamma ray observatory in space. It does not have the best angular resolution, as we mentioned, and it sees a burst on the sky. So it gives you this kind of large, maybe within 2 or 3 degrees, saying something happened there. Now that they radio that coordinate over to an X-ray satellite, which immediately points over, an X-ray can get down to arc minute, even sub-arc minute resolution. And they see a narrow point there. And at that resolution, an optical telescope can go look at it. So then they quickly point an optical telescope. You look at the spectrum, you look at the redshift by looking at the absorption lines, and you can tell where the galaxy is, where it came from, how far away it is. What we know about gamma ray bursts is they come from redshift of 1 to 2. So quite far away, sort of like the AGN, yeah. Same thing. And so they're not very close to us. So there are a lot of people that were talking about if we had a gamma ray burst in our galaxy, it'd be a disaster, it would destroy the Earth, and maybe the dinosaurs were killed by it. Maybe not. They occurred much earlier in the universe when probably the Earth was may not have even been around at that point.
Mm-hmm. Somebody asks if Betelgeuse will generate a gamma ray when it goes supernova.
I think it probably will. Yeah, it'll do something. It's a big star, and so you expect it to go up that upper sequence there where it'll wind up either making a neutron star or a black hole. When the supernova occurs, generally the gamma rays don't come out right away because it has an optically thick amount of material. As this thing pushes outward, you're pushing lots of material, and gamma rays actually will interact in that material as it expands. As it continues to expand, it becomes more tenuous, and at some point, the stuff comes out. Everything starts to stream freely outward from there. So people expect that it's delayed a little bit from the initial burst. If you looked at that gamma ray burst from the neutron star merger, it was delayed because the envelope had to expand a little bit and allow the gamma rays to come outward from there. So usually you don't see it exactly at the moment, but it'll be delayed.
Okay. Now, can VHE cosmic rays be made by particles or nuclei bouncing around and picking up energy in a very strong magnetic field?
That's actually where we think that they come from. If you have a gamma ray, it's hard to accelerate a photon. I mean, photons don't have any charge. So if I've got a light beam, if I've got a red light beam, how do I make it blue or green? There's actually no real way to do that easily, to double its energy. So if you've got very high energy gamma rays, then there has to be something with at least 10 times that energy that smashed into something and made these pions and the pion decayed. So when we see something which is 100 times the very high energy scale, that means it must have been at least a particle at 1,000 times. It could have been a cosmic ray or an iron nucleus. The fact that those are charged means that they can work with a magnetic field to be accelerated up to higher energies and or in shocks and supernovas, things like that.
That's awesome. Somebody asks, what would a next generation detector entail? What types of signal would be detected and what would be the size? Would it be Earth-based or space-based?
So for the very high energy gamma rays, the next generation is going to be ground-based. It's called shrink-off telescope array. And we've been working on it for the past 10 years. Instead of having four of our telescopes, you would have around 100 of them. And so I know you're going to be having a talk about ALMA. And if you look at the ALMA array, it's a I don't know, 60, 70 radio telescopes spread out over a kilometer. Exact same idea. We're going to have 60 or 70 of them spread out over a kilometer, probably in Chile next to the VLTI, the Very Large Telescope Interferometer in that region. It's kind of at high altitude. And they'll be separated by this sort of same sort of spacing we see in VERITAS, 100 meter spacing. And in the center, there'll be a very large telescope that'll have almost a 20 meter diameter of a telescope to be able to look at the lowest energies. And then as you move further outward, there's smaller telescopes that'll be probably 3 to 5 meter telescopes, and those will look at the highest energy cosmic rays. But with that, we'll have a square kilometer array, which will increase the effective area by a factor of 10 to 20 over what we have now, and a factor of 10 increase in sensitivity over what we have now.
Okay.
That's 200 million dollar observatory.
Okay. Now, does it make sense that cosmic rays can act as the triggers for lightning discharges?
That's an interesting question, and people have been arguing about this for years. It probably is true. I actually did a study of this using we were looking for the sources of these high energy cosmic rays, and what we needed is a lot of area. And so I was trying to think about how we can get a lot of area very cheaply without having to build anything. And it turns out there are always satellites that do interesting things. So there's one satellite that was an Air Force satellite called Forte, F-O-R-T-E. And what it was looking for was fast bursts of radio waves coming from a compact source someplace. And you can guess what that was. They're looking for a nuclear bomb to go off and trying to scan the Earth for that type of thing. So that operated for about 10 years and it looked over the entire sky. And it turns out that I was thinking that if I had a cosmic ray hitting the upper atmosphere, it could do exactly that. You get a high electric field that starts a cascade and makes a shower of particles and then makes a big electromagnetic wave. So you can look over the entire Earth in that thing. So I worked with Peter Gorham on that analysis. Peter actually wrote a paper on it about 15 years ago. We never saw any convincing events, but we were able to say at least up to these energies. This we could set limits on the existence of particles 10 to 100 times that particle that we saw. So we said that's 10 to the 20th. This set limits on things at 10 to the 21 or 10 to the 22 electron volts. So 10 to 100 times that extremely high energy scale. Think about that. That's like 100 bowling balls falling on your toe, or thanks, kind of like a truck falling on your toe in a single particle. That's a huge amount of energy. So that's one of the places I looked. The other one I looked at was lightning grids. And so the idea would be that, you know, do we ever see a lightning bolt coming from someplace out of the blue? In other words, no clouds around, this blue sky, and a lightning bolt. You know, people talk about metaphorically, I was hit by a lightning bolt out of the blue sky. Well, does that ever occur? So I talked to a professor who does these things up at the University of Rochester, asking him about this. And he goes, you know, whenever people come to me talking about that, they're completely crazy. But in fact, there are reports that these things exist. So I was thinking about looking in Antarctica, because there are no lightning storms in Antarctica. All lightning storms are associated with convective cells around the equator. If you go up to the North and South Pole, there's no lightning storms at all. So the question is, has anybody ever seen lightning at the North Pole or the South Pole? If you did, that'd be a pretty good indication that you're seeing cosmic rays triggering something. And he said, you know, you can't rule it out. He said that, you know, there have been credible people, scientists, that said they've seen a lightning bolt in a blue sky and nobody knows why. So open question, it'd be a good thing to study.
Yeah, it's fascinating. What was the time lag that you mentioned between the two neutron stars colliding and the spike in gamma rays? Was that hours? Was it days?
No, it was only a few minutes.
Oh, okay.
It was pretty fast. So that's what made it convincing. If it was wind up being a burst that happened days later, then people say, well, how often does this thing give you a flare? Maybe it's just a random occurrence. But the fact that it occurred so close in time and was seen by several detectors at the same time made it pretty convincing that you're seeing both gamma rays in between those at the same time.
Okay. Now, what or when was the most definitive observation in identifying the extra galactic sources of cosmic rays?
So there's a whole other field of astrophysics where they're actually studying the charged cosmic rays. There's two detectors, one's in Utah. I used to work on the FLYSI experiment. And then the high resolution flies eye, but now that's become much larger. It's called Telescope Array. And that's a consortium led by the University of Tokyo. It's quite a large area in the center of Utah. And they're seeing cosmic rays up to a few times 10 to the 20th electron volts. They still haven't beat our record at 3 times 10 to the 20th, interesting enough. But they've mapped out the spectrum, and they definitely see these, that there are this component of the very high energy ones. On the southern hemisphere in near Margalay and in Argentina, there is also the Auger project, which is a very large array of water tanks and optical detectors. And so what they're doing is they're trying to measure a large number of these and then map them back on the sky and see if they see some clustering. Are they coming from a group of galaxies, maybe perhaps a cluster of galaxies from the outside? They know that they're not going to see a point source because they don't have that good of a angular resolution. And even worse, they know it's going to be bent. But still, you'd expect things to be coming from the general region of the sky if perhaps there's a cluster of galaxies over in perhaps the Virgo galaxy or something like that. You might expect to see a general flow from that direction. So far, the evidence has been interesting but disappointing. Auger, the first turned on within the first 5 years, they were pretty sure they saw the plane of local galaxies. They were pretty sure they were seeing that in cosmic rays, and they saw it in almost a 5 standard deviation excess. And so they figured within the next 5 years, would be 7 or 8, and the significance would continue to grow. Well, just like many of the original gamma ray observations, when they followed it up, it just went downward and it just disappeared from being statistically significant. So now people claim that perhaps that was just some fluctuation in the count rate and it's not actually real. The subsequent to that, the telescope array has seen an enhancement in the northern hemisphere, which looks pretty credible. It took them about 10 years to get that, and it'll take another 5 to 10 years to get it up by another factor of square root of 2 in significance. So these are very, very long-term things, unless you make a really huge detector to expand that outward. And in fact, that's one of the things they're doing now, is they're expanding that by a factor of 3 to try to explore whether that excess really is real or not.
Mm-hmm. Somebody mentions that the telescopes are open to the environment. Do they not need to be covered when not in use, like an optical telescope?
Well, we would like to do that, but again, they're 12 meter diameter, yeah. So that'd be a big building. Building costs more than the telescope does. Each of those telescopes at Veritas, the first one cost us about $8 million to build it, and then the remaining 3 cost about $2 million to build. Of course, there's a lot of engineering in the beginning part of it. So a building for that size will probably be on the order of that $2 million. So I think we'd rather have the telescopes than the buildings, which don't do anything. So we have to point them north. From the northern hemisphere, you point them north during the daytime, and you keep them so the sun never shines on the mirror. I'll show you this one telescope we're working on right now. This is a my background. This is a next generation instrument that we're building, and it's called the Schwarzschild Coudé telescope. And it actually has two mirrors on it. I gotta get rid of that. And so you can see the primary, this is actually covered right now. So when it's covered, you can point it to wherever you want. When you're operating it, you take those covers off and you can see over here, the large primary mirror, and the secondary mirror is up with that big chunk of steel up on the top of it. It points back downward, and the camera is kind of in the middle. So the VERITAS telescopes have a very long snout because they're an F1.0 and they point outward. This is shorter because it's still an F1 optics, but it folds back on itself, so it's much shorter. It can slew faster. The interesting thing about the Schwarzschild Coudé telescope design is you can get out to 8 to 10 degree field of view, and you have exquisite, all the spherical aberrations and coma, they all cancel out. And so you have this exquisite, tiny, tiny spot size across the whole field of view. Okay, but how do we park it? That's the question. The way that we park it is you see it right now, that's the parking position. We actually have to park, we have three parking positions during the year. And so you have to have the sun, it has to be pointed perpendicular to the sun's plane where it crosses the sky. And we have these little baffles. So as the sun, if we didn't have the baffles on, you have to have 180 different positions. You have to have one every day, a slightly different position to park it every day. But with the baffles, you can get away with only having three positions to park it in the sky. So if you go see that one, that's during the daytime. It'll be pointed up in the sky during the wintertime because the sun's low on the horizon.
Oh, that's super. We just have a few more questions left and then we'll close out this meeting. But somebody asks that, There's a lot of different things to study in astronomy, and why is it that you picked gamma rays as a field of research?
There's two reasons for it. As I mentioned, gamma rays, they're like X-rays. You know, why do we use X-rays at the hospital? Because they go through things. So if you've got material in between, you want to look at your bones, you use an X-ray. Gamma rays are the same way; they penetrate through material, and so you can see the interiors of things. Many astrophysical systems are surrounded by gas. And if you look at the optical emission, you're just seeing the surface layer. You can't see into it. If I look at the sun, we only see that last surface scattering of the object. And so you only get the information about what's happening at the surface. If I want to know what's going deeper, then you've got to use X-rays, or you've got to use gamma rays, or even neutrinos, which can see down into the core of the sun. That's what I did as a graduate student. I actually was looking at neutrinos from the center of our sun. And so you can actually see what the fusion processes are, which you can't tell from the outside. So that's one of the reasons for using gamma rays. The second reason is there's a question about how do these gamma rays get to this high of an energy? So if Trevor Weeks looked and you give a talk about the zoo, you go to the zoo and what do they got there? They've got, you know, squirrels and rabbits and things like that. And nobody's watching those things. They're all looking at the elephant. And what people are saying, how did that thing get to be that big? Because it's just huge. And that's the same question here. How do these things get to be such a high energy? A million times our radio light. It just, you know, you can't imagine a process that energetic that can make something like that. So that's why we study them. They're just fascinating on their own, right? Because they're just so exceptional and so rare, but also so huge. And they carry so much energy associated with them.
Mm-hmm. And since they're ionizing radiation, does that impact the type of equipment to use to observe them?
So we only look at the optical part of it. The atmosphere shields us from these things. So remember, there's that shower of particles that terminates about 5 kilometers up in the air. So we rarely see the individual electrons hitting us. There are a few that make it down, but it's not a lot. When they first detected high energy cosmic rays, this was done by Victor Hess in 1910. They were seeing radiation that was coming on the Earth, a small amount of it. And they originally thought it came from the Earth itself. They knew about radioactive rocks and things like that. So they said, well, maybe if we take this radiation detector, I won't go into what it was, but it's a very crude instrument. And instead of having it on the ground here and counting how many cosmic rays or how much radiation is there, I'm going to go to the top of the Eiffel Tower. So they walked up to the top and they saw it change a little bit, but it was not really conclusive. And it's partly because it took time to climb up there and the atmosphere conditions changed. So when they put it in a balloon experiment, they saw as they went upward, they suddenly saw more ionization than before. And so that told you that it was not coming from the ground, it was coming from outer space. And so again, we're kind of protected here on the ground. But as you go to outer space, especially there's an upper layer of Van Allen belts where there's a lot of radiation there. That's something that, of course, we worry about for astronauts. People spending long durations in outer space, you worry about the radiation there much more than you do.
Yeah, definitely. And just to kind of a couple of questions back to neutrinos for a second. Somebody asks, what does a neutrino actually hit or interact with? And that kind of pairs up nicely with a question in the chat where it mentions that what would happen if a neutrino passing through the Earth actually hits some particle of the Earth rather than passing through?
So what it does is it scatters. It's like billiard balls. And so the neutrino itself, at these energies, you'll have it's most likely an electron that's in some atom in the ice, either a hydrogen atom or an oxygen atom. And if it hits close enough to the atom, it actually knocks the electron out and it'll make it transfer some of its energy. And the neutrino just keeps on going. It doesn't get absorbed, but just keeps on going. So it drops some of its energy and just keeps on going. So it's like having a very fast billiard ball hitting a stationary one. This one goes and this one gains a little bit of the energy. It can also cause the creation of these other particles, you know, charged particles, muons, things like that. And that's a separate process. But by far the most common process is hitting the electron and making a small electron track. That happens more often than anything else.
Of course. Somebody's curious, why does a collapsing star create a black hole versus a neutron star?
That has to do with the size of the core at the center. So it turns out if I take mass and I put it in a small enough volume, one of the interesting things about neutron stars, if it's got a mass and I add more mass to it, you think it gets larger and it doesn't. It actually gets smaller. And you add more mass and it shrinks more because it turns out there's nothing really holding the star up anymore. It's not like it's going to build out an outer layer. It just has more gravity, which makes it crunch down further and further. And when you crunch it down far enough, then you get to the critical region where you get the event horizon and it becomes the black hole. So it depends on the mass of whatever is being collapsed downward. Under certain circumstances, the more massive stars, it's a larger core. And when it collapses down, it goes beyond that critical point, becomes a black hole. Other ones, they stop before then. And then you have these intermediate things where you have a neutron star in a binary system. And often the binary star, like we saw, it can have gas. Neutron star can pick up that gas over a long period of time and actually gain mass. And eventually it can actually turn into a black hole.
Cool. And just one comment in the question and answer, astrophysics or quantum physics? I guess you're kind of involved in both the fields to understand gamma rays.
Yeah, a lot of it is quantum physics in terms of the production mechanisms. The detection mechanism is really kind of classical. It's just optical astronomy. It's very, very fast cameras. That's all in a large telescope. And the secret is being able to take an image of the sky. For the first 25 years I tried doing this, they were just looking at count rates. They figure they put a light sensor up and they point at the crab and you measure how many counts I see per second, how many clicks do I see? And then they would point it off source and say, how many clicks do I see? And sometimes they'd see an excess and sometimes they wouldn't. And it turns out they were dominated by the cosmic rays. Cosmic rays are 10,000 times more intense than the gamma ray. So the gamma ray is only a small fraction of all the particles hitting the upper atmosphere.
Well, that's really cool, and that brings us to our end to the end of our question and answer period. I see somebody mentioned yes, there will be a link that will be available. So stay tuned for that. You can find that on the Calgary Public Library YouTube page, and that you can find that in a few weeks. But on behalf of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada's Calgary Centre, Dr. Kita, I really appreciate you for speaking to us here this evening, and we'll be sending you a plaque and some other great things in your honorarium package, and that will be coming your way soon. Okay. And I would also like to express my gratitude to the astro imagers who generously shared their work, and I wish them continued clear skies and some amazing photons. And finally, thank you to our partner, the Calgary Public Library. Hamza Lale, thank you very much for hosting us this evening. And thank you all for joining us this evening. Uh, Before you sign off, I just would like to remind everybody of next month's lecture with Dr. Alhacha and Arif Hamad, and explore the history of science and astronomy during the golden age of Islam. Please sign up for this free event, and we really hope to see you here in a few weeks for this great upcoming lecture. And if you have any questions regarding the Calgary Center or the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, please feel free to drop onto one of our many social media outlets presented here on this slide, or send me an email if you have any questions. We're doing some really exciting things as a center. We're renovating the observatory. You can have full access to an observatory and talk with astronomers one-on-one and have classes where you can learn to observe the night sky. And we really hope to see you out at our events. And currently all our events are online, but shortly we'll be having live in-person events with telescopes to showcase the wonders of the night sky. So we really hope that you check out all of our stuff. And if you're very interested, please join the society and have some fun with astronomy. Again, thank you so much, Dr. Akita, for your wonderful presentation. Do you have any concluding remarks at all before we close off for the evening? I guess not. So, Hamza, can you provide us with your final words from the library and close us out, please? Or Lala?
Yes, I will do that. Thank you very much, Dr. Akita, for joining us tonight and our audience for attending this event. Thank you, Simon, for moderating, and Brian and Hamza for tech support. Please check out our website, calgarylibrary.ca, for more programs. And we have been collaborating with Royal Astronomical Society for a long time, and we will have more upcoming programs with them. And do check out their website as well at racs.ca. Thank you. Have a good night.